This past Friday, the grand jury here in Warren County heard evidence related to the March 2016 death of 4-year-old Austin Cooper. Earlier today, a 6-count indictment was filed against Austin's stepmother, Anna Ritchie, 25 years of age, from Franklin. Count 1 and count 2 of the indictment are for murder under what is known as the felony murder rule. Under count 1 murder, Mrs. Ritchie is charged with causing the death of Austin Cooper as a proximate result of committing the offense of endangering children. The murder count is categorized as a special felony under Ohio law. Under count 2 murder, Mrs. Ritchie is charged with causing the death of Austin Cooper as a proximate result of committing the offense of felonious assault. Again, that is a special felony under Ohio law. Count 3 of the indictment is endangering children. This is the underlying count for the first murder charge. The allegation is that Mrs. Ritchie recklessly abused Austin Cooper, who was under the age of 18, thereby resulting in serious physical harm to him. Endangering children under these circumstances is a felony of the second degree. Count 4 of the indictment is for felonious assault. Again, this felonious assault charge is the underlying charge for the count 2 murder. Mrs. Ritchie stands charged with knowingly causing serious physical harm to Austin Cooper. Felony assault or felonious assault is a felony of the second degree. Count 5 of the indictment is for involuntary manslaughter, a felony of the first degree. With that count, she's charged with causing the death of Austin Cooper as a proximate result of committing another felony. The other felony under the involuntary manslaughter count is actually a separate count of endangering children. That's the count 6 endangering children. Under that count 6 for endangering children, Mrs. Ritchie, as the person who is either the guardian, custodian, person having custody or control, or person in loco parentis of Austin Cooper, did recklessly create a substantial risk of health or safety of the child by violating a duty of care, protection, or support. The involuntary manslaughter charge is a felony of the first degree. The count 6 endangering children charge is tied to that particular count of the indictment. Mrs. Ritchie will be arraigned this Wednesday, April 20th at 9:30 a.m. in courtroom 2 here in the Warren County Common Police Court building. Many of these counts are going to merge at the time of sentencing, assuming she is convicted of these counts. So it's difficult for me to tell you today what the maximum possible sentence that she will face would be. However, the murder counts both are stated terms of 15 years to life in prison. At this point in time, I'm happy to answer any questions you may have.
Kind of go over the scenario of what took place that day.
The evidence that we have is that obviously Mrs. Ritchie is the stepmother of Austin Cooper. Mrs. Ritchie and her husband became the guardians, became the custodial parents of Austin back in January of this year, and she was essentially the primary caregiver during the daytime when Mr. Ritchie would work. It's our belief that she resented becoming the primary caregiver of this child, that she was somewhat rough in terms of her parenting style. By all accounts, Austin did not like to take baths. No 4-year-old does. But on this particular occasion of March 15th, in order to teach him a lesson as a form of punishment, so to speak, she decided to run scalding water in the bathtub. We believe that she placed him in that bathtub, that she held him in the bathtub for a period of 20 to 25 minutes. After taking him out of the bathtub, his skin was falling off of his legs. He was bleeding significantly. She placed him in pajamas and socks and put him in bed. And nobody checked on that child for a period of 4:30 p.m. on the 15th until 9:30 a.m. on the 16th when the father discovered him deceased.
Did you get toxicology results, and was there anything found in his system?
Yes, we did get toxicology results, and there's nothing in the system that would lead us to believe that any drugs were administered to the child or anything else that may have caused his death.
Could the father be charged also?
At this point in time, our focus in the case is on Mrs. Ritchie, so that's really our focus here today.
Can you talk, I guess, a little bit about the pain and suffering that this child went through?
Certainly. Our best estimate is that the temperature of the water was approximately 134 degrees, and when you're looking at temperatures at that level, I think based on just some of the research that we've done, you're talking about a scalding injury occurring somewhere between 1 and 4 seconds. So if this is actually a situation where the child is held in that tub for 20 to 25 minutes, certainly as you get to the end of that range, the air temperature is going to result in the water temperature being decreased on the end of that range. But just to be in that tub for a period of a minute or two would have to be just the most excruciating pain that you could go through. And the fact that, you know, obviously the allegations are that was done against a four-year-old child. I can't think of any scenario where any child would do anything that would that you could do that to a child. To me, as a father, it makes you angry that someone can do something like that to a child.
You've investigated a lot of cases. Where does this rank on the
it's disgusting. Yeah, in terms of the discuss, certainly, the homicide cases that we get, they're never clean. They're always messy situations. But this one hits particularly close to home, I think, for myself, for the people of our office, for the investigators from Franklin Police. You know, all of us either have children or grandchildren, and to see the type of injuries that were inflicted upon this child. We're talking half of his body being substantially burned to the point to where the skin's hanging on the bottom. I mean, that to me, the idea that you could do that to a child and then not get medical treatment for that child, in all likelihood for fear of being discovered as to what you did, it's just infuriating. And I think it's going to be a difficult case for any jury to sit through. But I think it's something that obviously is, we're going to do our best to bring justice to a child that, obviously his stepmother didn't care about.
Any indication that she abused the child before this?
No, we did not have any information. I know we've been asked that question in terms of any type of abuse that would rise to the level of a criminal charge. By all accounts, the evidence we believe will be that she was rough with the child, but not to the point to where it was a criminal offense, more like just inappropriately rough, so to speak, with the child, whether it was, pulling his clothes off at bedtime, putting a jacket on, just in their general treatment of the child. I think the statements from various witnesses that we received was she was rough with the child, she was inappropriate with the child. It was apparent that she didn't particularly care for this child, and perhaps was resentful of the fact that now somebody who is not a parent, she's 25 years of age, she doesn't have any of her own children, now she's going to be essentially the primary caregiver for a four-year-old child that's not hers and that she didn't particularly want. And so that, I think, was the evidence that we had in terms of the history, so to speak, but nothing along the lines of any type of criminal abuse of the child. Nothing that would have led anyone to believe that something like this would occur. I don't know what you could do to a child that would lead you to believe that something like this would occur.
Did neighbors hear anything that particular time period or in the past prior to this?
No, there's no reports that the neighbors heard anything on that particular day. Obviously, that was something that was one of our first questions, because you can't place a four-year-old child in scalding water and not expect blood-curdling screams. I know that there was one of the, this is, I believe, a four-unit apartment complex. I think one of them was either vacant or temporarily vacant at that particular time, and it may have been the one that was closest to the residence where Mr. and Mrs. Ritchie lived. So that could have had something to do with it. No reports from the neighbors that they heard anything on this particular day.
Was Dad unaware of this rough treatment?
I think Dad was aware of the rough treatment, maybe some inappropriate treatment of the child, I would say that he was likely aware of that.
Was she around other children, distant family members that she may have worked at a daycare for a church?
I'm not aware of that.
In terms of the night of?
Right.
As far as what she told you all, or investigators, she was, what, for punishment? She was doing this to this four-year-old?
I can't make any comment on any statements that she specifically made. What I can tell you is, based on the evidence that we have, we believe that she implemented this as a form of punishment. This was a child that did not like to take baths. No child likes to take baths, but perhaps to her not having children, this seemed like it was something unusual. But at the end of the day, she decided that because he was frequently difficult around bath time, that she was going to use this opportunity to teach him a lesson. And so she drew a scalding tub of bath water and held him down in it for approximately 20 to 25 minutes.
Do we know the exact cause of death?
Hypovolemic shock is the cause of death. Hypovolemic shock is basically a situation where, as a result of these burns, you lose blood and you lose fluid. And when you lose that significant amount of blood and fluid without any type of IV treatment or anything to restore those fluids in your system, essentially the heart doesn't have enough blood, or at least quality blood, to pump through the body. Eventually you're going to see your blood pressure bottom out, the heart's going to stop working, and all the organs are going to start shutting down. And that's what we believe, it's not what we believe, that's what the coroner's ruling the cause of death.
Was it tap water, or was it tap water, or did she boil something up in the kitchen? Or
at this point in time, the only evidence that we have is the tap water.
You guys tested the tap water in that apartment? I'm sure that's part of the investigation, but
we believe the water temperature was approximately 134 degrees from that hot water heater at the settings that it was at on that day.
The father had custody, is that, if I recall?
That's my understanding, yes.
Do you know what the circumstances were?
I do know that on the other side there's drug issues. Last Monday I indicted Austin's stepfather for drug trafficking. So, obviously, issues on the other side of the family as well. This was not a children's services custody issue that happened back in January. This was between the mother and the father. To my understanding, mother did not show up for the custody hearing, and custody was awarded to the father. And obviously, she is the stepmother.
If she's convicted as charged, how much time is she looking at?
Merger issues are going to come into play, but on the murder count, that is a set 15 years to life sentence. The only other one that possibly could come into play would be the involuntary manslaughter. The involuntary manslaughter charge, based on that underlying child endangering, so the first four counts relate to her conduct in placing the child in the tub and causing those injuries and ultimate death of the child at that point in time. The involuntary manslaughter and the underlying child endangering charge that are counts 5 and 6 of the indictment, those relate to her failure to seek medical treatment for the child once she determined that certainly he was bleeding profusely, skin was falling off his basically the bottom half of his body. The failure to obtain any type of medical treatment is what resulted in the counts 5 and 6. The horrible part about this was a completely treatable injury. Believe it or not, as severe as these injuries were, to the extent that medical treatment would have been obtained, the medical treatment that is administered typically is IV fluid. You put the child on IV fluid, I'm sure they would have done something for the horrific pain that he was in. But as far as the critical treatment that needed to be done, he needed to have IV fluids administered to him as quickly as possible. And the failure to do that ultimately resulted in the child's death.
So if she took him to the hospital after this happened, he would have been okay, probably, or as okay as he could be?
No, I would not have been okay. But if the child had not died, she wouldn't be facing murder charges. She wouldn't be facing involuntary manslaughter charges. She would be facing felonious assault, and she would be facing the first count of endangering children. But yes, she would have definitely been charged.
No, but so, I mean, the child would have been able to survive.
We believe that... Our understanding in terms of the medicine with respect to this and our consultation with our experts is that had this child been administered treatment within those first few hours after this injury occurred, the child would have had somewhere above a 95% chance of survival.
What is this like just for your office to have to look into this and then also get in depth enough to take this to trial with these?
It's horrible. I mean, it's horrible. And as I said a moment ago, you know, I think the first big case I had when I became prosecutor was the death of a deputy that got killed in the line of duty. Obviously, one of the more recent ones, Justin Back, in terms of his brutal murder by Austin Myers and Tim Mosley. I would put this case right up with those two in terms of just how it affects everybody in the office. You're not used to looking at four-year-olds on a table being autopsied. That's not something natural for anybody, whether you're a law enforcement officer, whether you're a prosecutor, whether you're the coroner. That's not supposed to happen. And so when you have a situation where you're having to deal with that, it takes a toll on everybody involved. And I have no doubt that, you know, at the end of this case that, you know, those images aren't going to go away from anybody's mind. The jurors, the grand jurors that had to look at the evidence on Friday, the jurors that are going to have to look at this when it goes to trial, you members of the media are going to have to see it when you're covering the trial, and it's just not something that you're ever going to forget. Other questions?
What are the special circumstances of the murder charges? I'm sorry.
In terms of
the felony murder? Yeah.
Okay, so it's felony murder. It is the causing the death through, as a proximate result of committing, for count one, endangering children, for count two, felonious assault. So if you cause the death of another as the proximate result of you committing felony two, child endangering, that is murder under the felony murder rule. If you cause the death of another through the commission of felonious assault as a proximate result of committing the felonious assault, that also is murder. Felonious assault being knowingly causing serious physical harm, and then when you're talking about endangering children, count two, felony two, endangering children, that is basically recklessly abusing the child, thereby resulting in serious physical harm.
So those are charges to be considered by the jury, correct?
Those will be considered by the jury, correct.
Those are charges that could be merged or should not be found guilty of both of those.
That's correct. Those would merge,
okay,
definitely.
Thank you.
Yeah, those two counts would merge, correct.
But she could be found guilty of the murder charge and involuntary manslaughter?
That's correct. She could be kept, she could be charged, and frankly, to the extent that there wouldn't be a merger on sentencing, the counts that would most likely not be merged would be the murder count, one or two, those would be merged together, and the involuntary count, okay? Because the underlying endangering, felonious assault, and endangering are going to get merged into the murder, and involuntary manslaughter. But there is a possibility that one of the murder counts would not be merged with the involuntary manslaughter because one had to do with the act of placing the child in the tub and causing that injury. The other had to do with the failure to obtain medical treatment.